All right, good evening, everybody. And if you see me flipping through this, it's not notes, it's my slides. Because if I don't have my slides here, I'll be three slides ahead, and everybody will wonder what I'm talking about. So as Carl said, I'm Andy Puzder. I was the CEO of CKE Restaurants, but I was not born with a silver spoon in my mouth. I grew up in a working class family in Northern Ohio, Cleveland, Ohio. My grandfather came to this country in 1912. An immigrant from the Austro-Hungarian Empire, and looking for freedom and opportunity like so many immigrants before him. My dad, when I was growing up in Cleveland, was a World War II combat vet and a Ford car salesman. We were just an ordinary working class family living outside of Cleveland. You didn't really think about it that way, but it's kind of different now. Back then, you really didn't think about yourself as working class. I mean, everybody seemed to be working class. The kids on TV were working class. The kids in school were working class. It was the life I knew. That was until one day when my dad asked me to go with him to deliver a car to a very rich individual in a very rich neighborhood, really just a few miles from our house. But it was a world I'd really never seen before. I told him I'd go with him. We pulled in front of this beautiful big gate. Now it's 1960, I was 10 years old. In my mind, the gate's huge. Now, how big it is actually, I can't tell you. But back then, it seemed huge. It opens up wide, you know, opens up. We go in, beautiful driveway, perfectly landscaped lawn and shrubbery. And the house, it was sunset. The house seemed to almost shine. In my huge house, my dad just keeps driving. I said, Dad, where are you going? Why didn't you stop? And he looked down and said, Son, that was the guest house. We kept going around the corner. There were stables. This was called, the area outside of Cleveland is called Hunting Valley, if any of you are from the Cleveland area. That's a very wealthy area. It was back then even more than it is now. But they had fox hunting. They had a polo field nearby in Chagrin Falls, and people had horses. So we had beautiful stables, probably nicer than the little ranch house my family and I lived in. We run around the corner. We pull up to a huge house that in my mind's eye is like Downton Abbey. Now, whether it really is or not, I can't tell. I'd have to go back and look. But to a 10-year-old who grew up in a, 2,000-square-foot ranch house, this place looked huge. The man who owned it was named Mr. Humphrey. He and my dad knew each other. My dad walked up to the front door. He exchanged keys with Mr. Humphrey. They talked for a little bit. I'm just awed by the incredible, incredible surroundings, the affluence that I'm surrounded with. Finally, my dad, we start walking back to the car, and I'm stunned. And I said to my dad, I said, Dad, what does Mr. Humphrey do that he can live like this? And my dad said, well, he's a lawyer and he runs a business. I can still remember thinking, like it was yesterday, I said, a lawyer, I could be a lawyer. Now, it's important that I thought that. What's more important is what I didn't think. I didn't think that son of a bitch is stealing from us. He's in the 1%, and we're in the whatever percent you're in when your dad sold Fords in the, 1960s. None of that occurred to me. What occurred to me was I could do that. And luckily, I lived in a country where I could do that. I lived in a capitalist country where I had the potential to do that. The country my grandfather came from, he would have died as a serf if he hadn't left his home and his family and his friends. As a teenager, really younger than you, about 15, probably the same age as some of you, he came to the United States. If he hadn't done that, rather than talking to you here tonight, I'd probably be a bald and toothless farmer sitting on a porch in Slovakia. I mean, capitalism is an incredible, incredible system. And in fact, I did end up running, being a lawyer. I went to law school. I ended up running a business, got a nice big house of my own in California. I've now moved to Nashville. I couldn't live in California anymore. It's just unlivable. I'm not a socialist. I can't live in a socialist state. But I did. I actually became a lawyer who ran a business. Now, there isn't another country in the history of the world where a working class kid like me would have had the opportunity to accomplish what I've been able to accomplish. Not another country in the history of the world. I was able to do it because of capitalism. If I'd have been born in a socialist country, rather than working my way from the working class on up, the idea of leaving the working class probably would never have occurred to me, and if it had occurred to me, it would have seemed like an impossible dream. But today, young Americans seem enamored with the concept of socialism. Now, I'm not sure why that is. Back in 1991, which seems like a long time ago to you guys, probably before you were born, you know, I was 41. It doesn't seem that long ago. President Reagan had just stopped being president. President Bush was president. The Soviet Union fell. The Soviet Union, the Union of the Soviet Socialist Republics, was the largest socialist economy ever to exist on the face of the earth. When it collapsed, we all thought socialism had finally been defeated. It had collapsed of its own weight. You know, all the people on the left had supported, academics had supported it, the media had supported it. It just fell. It just fell of its own weight. The joke at the time was that the only place you could find a socialist was the faculty lounge at Harvard. You know, things have changed. Socialism's having a renaissance. Now, why young Americans would be enamored with socialism is beyond me. I mean, they seem to view capitalism as a system based on greed and oppression. That's just not true, and I'll get to that in a minute. But why would young people believe this? Well, you've got the grandfatherly face of Bernie Sanders and the charm and charisma of Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez. You ever see the video of her dancing? I mean, really, I watched it. I felt better when I was done watching it. It's kind of up. I wish she would do that more and stop talking. You know, she should dance. she should dance. It's very uplifting. But with those two individuals and with really an education system that teaches young Americans leftist ideology as truth, even though it's been historically disproven everywhere it's been tried, it's taught as truth. And then we have a media complex that feeds young Americans leftist ideology as entertainment. So you find a lot of support among millennials and now Gen Xers for socialism. In fact, there was a poll by Gallup last year that found that 51% of young Americans viewed socialism favorably and only 45% viewed capitalism favorably. Now that's a little scary, but over time that'll change. Winston Churchill once said, if you're not a liberal when you're young, you have no heart. If you're not a conservative when you're old, you have no brain. So people seem to evolve into more conservative thought over time. What was scary was that in 2010, the number that viewed capitalism favorably was 68%. That means in 9 years, we've come down 23 percentage points from 68% favorable to 45% favorable. YAF did a poll recently. You may have seen something about it. But they did a poll of Gen Xers. Gen Xers, only 40% viewed capitalism favorably. But the interesting thing is that 83% viewed small businesses favorably. I think 73% viewed entrepreneurs favorably, right? And 63% viewed free markets favorably. I mean, what do you guys think capitalism is, right? That's what it is. That's what it's entrepreneurs, small businesses, and free markets. So the problem is kids aren't being taught what socialism and capitalism are. In fact, of the 35% that viewed socialism more favorably, 27% couldn't tell you what it was. 10% thought it was free stuff. You know, I mean, so when I start these talks, I generally start with a definition, so we're all talking about the same thing. And many of you, because you're here, so you obviously are interested in these topics, so you may already be aware of this, but socialism is an economic system where the building blocks of the economy, the means of production, distribution, and exchange, are owned or controlled through regulation by the state. Capitalism, on the other hand, is an economic system where those same building blocks are owned and controlled by individuals. Now, why is the left, why are progressives having so much success with this socialism idea? We talked about education, we talked about the entertainment industry. But what they've been very good at conveying is this myth. Our country's not the first place this has been tried. This has historically been used in many, many places. But the myth is that socialism is necessary and even desirable to protect the oppressed masses from capitalist greed. Now, it's not true. It's a myth. But where did the myth come from? Well, a good place to start is the entertainment industry. This is a movie back in the end of the Reagan administration. There was a movie called Wall Street. If you haven't seen it, you ought to watch. It's ridiculous. It's humorous. But Michael Douglas was supposed to be the quintessential capitalist as viewed by Hollywood. And he played a character named Gordon Gekko. And Gordon Gekko said very famously in this movie, greed is good. But you know, outside of Hollywood, greed is not good. And capitalism is not based on greed. And I think I'll be able to prove it to you. When I ran CKE Restaurants, when I ran Carl's Jr., the company that owned Carl's Jr. and Hardee's, we didn't produce the burgers that I wanted to eat. We didn't produce the burgers that the politically elite wanted to eat. We tried to figure out what you wanted to eat. We spent millions of dollars every year, and so did our competitors, trying to figure out what American consumers wanted, particularly young people in our industry, and how to convince you that we had it at a price you wanted to pay. Because in a capitalist society, the way you succeed is by meeting the needs of other people, right? You succeed by taking your desire to improve your life and expanding it out to others. Think about your local grocery store, or this is the Amazon warehouse, or a local shopping mall. The hundreds of thousands of products, each one of which represents an entrepreneur trying to convince you that they have what you want at a price you can afford to pay. You determine their success. Capitalism is the purest form of economic democracy. You vote with every dollar you spend on who succeeds and who fails. The BlackBerry versus the iPhone. You know, Studebakers, which are gone, you probably don't remember it, but it used to be a car company. Versus, you know, Ford or Toyota. And the extent to which you're able to meet the needs of other people is the extent to which you will personally benefit. Henry Ford, for example, when he made cars, he didn't make them for kings and queens of his age. He made them for the common man and the common woman. Steve Jobs, he didn't make iPhones for politically elites in this country, for the Bernie Sanders and the Elizabeth Warrens, if you know they ever get to be president. He made iPhones for all of us. Because by satisfying our needs, you succeed. That's this incredible, incredible ability to take your desire for success, that which everybody has, and factor it out to other people. Now, that's not purely altruistic or charitable conduct, because it's based on your desire to improve your life. But what it does is it turns it into something like benevolent conduct, because the only way you succeed is by meeting the needs of others. That's capitalism. What about socialism? What do you do in socialism? Is it socialism? Do you have to meet the needs of other people? Socialism's just the opposite. If you're in a socialist country, what you're focused on is getting the most you can for yourself from a limited supply of goods or services that the government makes available. Now, socialist countries inevitably have bread lines. This is bread lines in the USSR, Cuba, Venezuela, and North Korea, the three most prominent socialist countries today. If you're standing in a line waiting for bread, or if you're standing in a line waiting for gas, or if you're standing in a line waiting for government rationed health care, you're not thinking about what the people in front of you or behind you in line want, right? You're thinking about how you can get the most for yourself from that limited supply that's available. And how do you get the most for yourself in a socialist country? Well, not by meeting the needs of consumers. In a capitalist country, we all control the economy. We drive the economy. You guys drive it. In a socialist country, you have to meet the needs of the people who drive the economy. And who are they? The political elites. Think about North Korea. North Korea, you have a shortage of virtually, it's a prison colony. You've got shortages of virtually every consumer good, right? People can't leave. People can't get good medical care. People can't eat. There's not enough food. What about the political leaders? Does it look like Kim Jong-un's missed any meals lately? Who's eating the food in that country? How about Venezuela, right? Venezuela is run by Maduro. Used to be run by Hugo Chavez. You know, this country is in desperate straits, right? The people, there's not only is there no food, you know, people can't get health care. They're flocking out to Colombia and Brazil, and they're taking diseases with them, diseases we thought were wiped out decades ago, and they're spreading them. Does it look, you know, families that they're eating their pets? Can you imagine making, you know, you guys don't have kids yet, but could you imagine making your kids eat your pets? I mean, Fido. It's a horrific, right? I mean, who could do that? Does it look like Maduro and his military guys and his buddies? Does it look like they're eating their pets? I doubt it. You know, the interesting thing about Venezuela is that about 10 years ago, it was the richest country in South America. It sits on an ocean of oil. It literally has the highest volume of petroleum reserves of oil of any country in the world, more than Saudi Arabia, more than Russia, more than the United States. And the people are starving, even though they sit on all that wealth. You know, this is the benevolence of socialism. Capitalism, because you're always trying to meet the needs of other people, produces what? Abundance, prosperity. Socialism, because you're competing with everybody else to get the most you can for yourself, produces poverty and want. Now, every place has been tried. You know, today I could give you historical examples, but just think about this during your life: North Korea, Cuba, Venezuela. They're in terrible, terrible economic straits. So what do socialists say? Even Bernie Sanders last night. They say, we're not those countries. We're Denmark. You know, Denmark is us. We're the Denmark socialists. There's only one problem with saying you're the Denmark socialist. Denmark is a free market capitalist economy. In fact, when Bernie Sanders was running around in 2016, and again at the debate last night, saying we're Denmark, we're democratic socialists, forget those other countries, we're Denmark. The Prime Minister of Denmark got irritated, as did the Danes, and he came to the United States. And what he said was, he spoke at Harvard. He said, I know that some people in the U.S. associate the Nordic model with some sort of socialism. Doesn't sound like he likes socialism, does it? Therefore, I would like to make one thing perfectly clear. Denmark is far from a socialist planned economy. Denmark is a market economy. Denmark's capitalist. In fact, the Heritage Foundation here in D.C. comes out with an index of economic freedom every year. And they rank from 1 to 180 the countries of the world. From most free, by the way, the most free last year was Hong Kong. So, you know, say your prayers for the people in Hong Kong. The least free, what do you think the least free are? North Korea, Cuba, and Venezuela, the countries where people are starving. On that list, Denmark's number 14. It's the 14th freest economy in the world. It's not socialist. It is the 14th freest economy in the world. Now, just to give you something for comparison purposes, the United States is number 12. I mean, they're almost as economically free as we are, right? This just isn't true. Now, there's another practical test another practical way you can tell that Denmark is a capitalist economy. Denmark has a very generous welfare system. Now, they have high taxes and a generous welfare system. I mean, we can debate whether that's a good idea or a bad idea. Does it discourage work? Do you get economic growth? Do you have a satisfied, happy people? And the Danes have been debating that for about 15 years, and they've actually reduced benefits and reduced taxes. But the one thing you know for sure is they have to be a capitalist country, because only a capitalist country could pay those welfare benefits. Socialist countries never produce enough wealth to cover what they promise. They can't even produce food. You know, the first thing they always run out of seems to be toilet paper. I don't know why that is, but that seems to be something the socialist countries have a very difficult time coming up with. All right, so we know socialism produces poverty and want. We know capitalism produces abundance and prosperity. But does that abundance and prosperity reach down to people at the common man and common woman, the working class? Or are we just enriching people that are already rich? Is this the rich get richer, the poor get poorer? So I'm going to show you a little bit of the history of capitalism. And the first chart I'm going to show you was prepared by something called the Angus Madison Institute. Angus Madison was a historical economist. He studied the past. Normally economists tell you what's going on now or what they think is going to happen next quarter. He studied the past. And his institute came up with his institute came up with a chart that was published in the Atlantic magazine back in about 2015. And this is a chart that shows from the year zero through the year, probably about 2015, 2020, GDP per capita for the entire world. Now, what does that mean? GDP per capita is a very fancy way of saying economic output per person, right? GDP is economic output. It's considered the best way to measure whether or not a country is economically productive, in this case, the world. And per capita is just Latin for per person. Now, why do economists say GDP per capita instead of just economic output per person? I think they want to sound smarter than they are. This really isn't that complicated an idea. And you can see, like, around 1800, around 1800, this really shoots up. I mean, there was no wealth in the world. I mean, you lived for that 2,000-year period. You're in pretty bad shape. There was not a lot of wealth in the world. And then all of a sudden, it shoots up. Now, why did it shoot up? What caused this? You know, this rise here, this affected everybody in this room. It affected everybody on the planet. It affected your parents, your grandparents, your great-grandparents. This is an incredible, incredible event. You don't hear much about it because the reason it jumped up was capitalism. Now, I showed this to a millennial son of mine who's now about 27 and works at Ford about 3-4 years ago. And he said, you know, Dad, you're going to tell me this is capitalism, but it's really just the Industrial Revolution, right? Said there was an Industrial Revolution, things got better. So I said, well, let's look at another chart. Let's look at the chart that breaks that big rise down by region so you can see where it happened and when it happened first. And you can see it happened first in the United States. Well, why did it happen first in the United States? It happened really around 1800, right? Around the time we ratified the Constitution, 1789. Well, it happened in the United States first for two reasons. And it was a very fortuitous coincidence that in 1776, we signed the Declaration of Independence, and there was a book that came out called The Wealth of Nations by Adam Smith. Adam Smith described in that book how you would set up a modern capitalist economy and why you'd want to. The founders read the book, established a capitalist economy in the United States, and within 100 years, by 1885, so from 1789 to 1885, 13 backwoods colonies on the coast of North America became the world's largest economy. Really, historically, the blink of an eye, we went from nothing to the world's largest economy, even surpassing the British Empire. And you can see that after the Civil War, we kind of went straight up. Well, the Civil War, what happened to the Civil War was that we abolished the feudal economic system that existed in the South. Once we did that, the country just, nothing could stop us. Now, Western Europe, right? Germany, Great Britain, now the United Kingdom, they had an Industrial Revolution, and they are the blue line here. And you can see they went up some, right? They went up a little, and then they just shot straight up. Well, why'd they shoot straight up? End of World War II. What happened at the end of World War II? Germany collapsed. The National Socialist Party collapsed, and as those of you who have had a decent history course would know, the National Socialist Party was the Nazi Party. The Nazis were very proud socialists. They actually got along great with Stalin until their desires to occupy the same territory clashed. The most impressive line on this chart is Japan. Look how Japan goes from way down here, and this is through World War II. They had an Industrial Revolution too. They had boats and planes and tanks. They fought in World War II. Then they shoot straight up. They actually, for the first time in the history of the world, have higher GDP per capita than Western Europe. What happened in Japan? Well, at the end of World War II, General MacArthur went into Japan, set up a democratic system of government and a free market capitalist economy. China, Eastern Europe shoots up. When does Eastern Europe shoot up? Fall of the Soviet Union. Red China shoots up. When does China shoot up? Well, when they deserted traditional socialism and adopted what they call red capitalism. It's not even real capitalism. It's just like watered down capitalism. It's like government run capital. And even that lifted them up. So capitalism has had a tremendous impact across the planet. This desire, your ability to improve other people's lives, produces abundance. That's what this shows. But does the abundance reach, again, does it reach people at the bottom of the economic ladder? Well, a group called the World Bank, and they're a an institution that's located in Europe, and they make loans to third world countries to try and help them economically, and they do a lot of research across the planet. They did some research to look at how many people were living in extreme poverty back in 1820, and how many people are living in extreme poverty today. Well, the fact of the matter is, back in 1820, 94 out of every 100 people, 94% of people lived in extreme poverty. Now that doesn't, now this, there were six people that didn't live in extreme poverty. That doesn't mean they weren't in poverty. Probably three or four of them just lived in regular poverty. I mean, these people were like in extreme poverty. All you ever hear about in a history course are the kings, the queens, the emperors, you know, the scientists. You never hear about this 94% that lived in extreme poverty. If you don't believe it, you know, even in the early 1800s, read a book by Charles Dickens. I mean, there was a lot of poverty back then. That's come down. By 2015, that was down to 10 people in 100. It's actually 9.6, so technically probably under 10. Today, I'm sure it's single digits. That's an incredible drop, right? That's an incredible decline. At the same time, GDP per capita is going up. We've reduced extreme poverty across the globe, unlike any time in the history of the world, all due to capitalism. Right? Now, it's important that we did this, but 10 is still too many. We need to get that number even lower. But to do that, we have to know why it happened, which is one of the reasons I'm here talking to you tonight. I had a buddy of mine who's a kind of a techie, younger guy, very technically oriented. I asked him to take the Angus Madison GDP per capita data and combine it with the World Bank data on poverty to see if they correlated. This is the chart. He said he's never seen a correlation so direct, and he does a lot of these charts. Now, unless I've spoken about this chart before, so it may be online somewhere, because I don't care if people take pictures and share it, but it, other than here, you're probably not going to see it anywhere else. This is an incredible, incredible, incredible demonstration of what capitalism can do and what it does to help people that live in poverty at the bottom of the economic scale. Now I want to show you, I'll show you two more charts, but I'll show you one more on this subject. I wanted to put some charts in the book that's in front of you. I managed to get the publisher to let me put two in, but she said charts are death. People get bored. So I hope you're not too bored, but I'm going to show you what happened when the Soviet Union collapsed. This is a chart by an Austrian historian using World Bank data. And he looked at what happened from the collapse of the Soviet Union in 1991 with respect to hunger, poverty, illiteracy, child mortality, and pollution across the world. They dropped like a rock. Once the Soviet Union was no longer a dominant economy and China switched from pure socialism to a form of red capitalism. Look, less hunger, less poverty, fewer children dying. You know, that's the benevolence of capitalism. This isn't a system based on greed. It isn't a system where you succeed by being greedy. It's a system where you succeed by helping others, and the benefits are spread across a broad spectrum of individuals. Now, why does this happen? Well, one of the best explanations for it came from a Democratic president. He was actually running for president when my dad and I went to Mr. Humphrey's house. His name was John F. Kennedy. And when he was arguing for tax cuts, he actually got Congress, they enacted it after he was assassinated, but he wanted Congress to enact one of the most dramatic tax cuts in history. He and Ronald Reagan and then President Trump presided over the three biggest tax cuts. He said a rising tide lifts all boats. What did he mean by that? He meant a rising economic tide lifts everybody. It lifts the rich, it lifts the middle class, it lifts the working class, it lifts the poor. A rising economic tide lifts everybody. Why is that important? Because the justification for socialism is class warfare. They believe that wealth is a zero-sum game. What do I mean by that? They believe that the rich only get richer because the poor get poorer, or that the poor will only do better if the rich get poorer. In other words, that's how they justify the government coming in and redistributing income. If, in fact, everybody's better off with economic growth, well, what idiot wouldn't want economic growth, right? I mean, if you have to punish people to try and balance the economy, those people aren't going to be generating economic growth, right? That's why socialist countries do so poorly. And you can see this in the United States today. You can see it even comparing More recently, the Barack Obama presidency to just the first 2.5 years of the Trump presidency. When last year, the World Economic Forum, you may have heard of them, they have an event in Davos, Switzerland every year that gets a lot of publicity. But they have something what they call the Global Competitiveness Index. They rank the most competitive countries in the world. As of last year, 2018, the 2019 edition isn't out yet, we were the most competitive nation in the world for the first time since 2008. So for the first time since the election that put President Obama into office. By the way, you might notice Sweden and Denmark are number 9 and 10. You know, they're not capitalist countries, right? And if you look at what's happening, as I said, with the Index of Economic Freedom, this year we were number 12. Last year, when President Trump took office, we were number 18. In 2008, when Barack Obama was elected, we were number 5. So we're moving back up. We're seeing progress. And you can see, all you have to do is pay attention to the numbers. We have the lowest unemployment rate in 50 years. You know what that means? That means the last time the unemployment rate was this low, I was 19 years old. We've had a year, we have 13 months actually, so a year and a month, with 3% wage growth. We haven't had 3% wage growth for a decade. Now we're rolling over 3% on top of 3%. I mean, it's incredible. Look, think about the tech industry. The tech industry is very affected by economic circumstances, regulatory requirements, taxes. They can grow when they're low. And here's what's happened with respect to the tech industry. Here's President Trump's election. This is the recession back there. Comes through here. It goes up under President Obama. And then look what's happened since President Trump was elected. He cut taxes. He reduced regulation. He focused on domestic energy production. And the economy just flew away. You know, we're actually to the point, and this is kind of one of the more interesting statistics on the economy, at least for me. When President Trump took office, there were 1.9 million more people unemployed than there were job openings. The federal government tracks how many job openings we have and how many people don't have jobs. And there were almost 2 million people more who were unemployed than there were job openings. That changed in March of 2018. So really a year and a month after President Trump was elected, it switched to where there were more job openings than people unemployed. You know, last month, the most recent data is for July. It came out about a week ago. There are now 1.2 million more job openings than people unemployed. We've gone from 2 million more unemployed people to 1.2 million more job openings. That's why I call my book The Capitalist Comeback. This is 2.5 years. Can you imagine if we can keep this up? We've actually gone from an economy where the biggest problem was business, that there were too many unemployed people and not enough jobs. At Carl's and Hardee's, we were hiring people with college educations to clean the restrooms and work the counters because they couldn't find any other job. We've actually gone from that economy to an economy where the biggest problem facing American businesses is they can't find enough workers to fill the open, good quality jobs. That's a capitalist comeback. Now, should this be important to you? Well, it should be important to you if you want a job when you get out of college, or even out of high school if you decide not to go to college. You want to succeed. You want to be successful. You want other people to be successful. The good news is that the economic system into which you were born is the best economic system literally in the history of the world for seeing that you can accomplish those goals. You know, our system takes American farmers. American farmers feed the world because by feeding the world, they can better feed themselves and their families. Our entrepreneurs go into dilapidated areas of cities, the inner cities. They build new restaurants, hotels, grocery stores. They revitalize areas because it will benefit them, and by benefiting themselves, they can benefit their communities. Capitalism is the best economic system ever devised for the poor and the marginalized. It empowers them as consumers who vote with every dollar they spend so that everybody's focused on them. And it creates the opportunities that can lift them and improve their lives. And it can lift you and improve your life. The system's capitalism. The goal is to achieve the American dream. Now, Ronald Reagan, he said a lot of really smart things. So I'm just picking this one out because it works for my speech. But he said, freedom is always one generation away from extinction. Kind of a terrifying thought, really. Whether you're that generation, whether you're the generation that preserves our economic and political freedom and hands it to the next generation in as good or better shape than you got it, or whether you're the generation that finally sacrifices those economic freedoms and political liberties, that's really completely up to you. And I want to say God bless you in your endeavors, and may God bless the United States of America. Thank you. Now, I think I saved time for, by the way, I'm happy to sign books when this is over, but if I sign a book, you have to read it. That's the deal. And I think, how much time do I have? I have time. I think I went pretty quick. Yeah. And by the way, I will make no money on this book. Whatever profits there, I'm donating to charity, right? I know this guy just gave us this big speech on capitalism, and now he tells us he's going to donate the money to charity. But the point of the book wasn't for Andy Puzder to make money. I'm fine. I think I'm going to donate it to a charity that focuses on entrepreneurship in minority communities, because I think we need to balance things a little bit. And if I can help, I'm happy to help. So, and I didn't want people saying, "Oh, you just wrote this book to make a buck." It's not true. Yes, young lady.
Thank you for your lecture.
No, you're
My
welcome.
Name is Joey Wee. I'm from Linwood, and I'm homeschooled in high school.
Good for you.
May I ask two questions?
Sure.
Thank you. The first one is, what is the biggest argument, and what are your thoughts on it?
The biggest argument for what?
Socialism. Sorry.
Well, the big argument is that it's benevolent. I mean, that's what they're out there telling you, right? Doesn't Bernie Sanders and Elizabeth Warren, aren't they, and Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez, they're trying to convince you that socialism means they're generous. Now, of course, they're being generous with your money, but they're being generous, right? They want you to empower the government. They want you to give them the money to do good, right? And then they want you to put them in charge of this newly empowered government. I mean, that's what they really, but that's their argument. Their argument is that this is generous. They're just good people trying to help the poor.
Okay. And my second question is, because the younger generation is so enamored by socialism, do you think that the United States economy is at any risk of falling into socialist hands?
Well, it is at risk. I would tell you that my generation was probably just as obnoxious on this issue. Back in the days of the Vietnam War, there was people walking around with Ho Chi Minh sign. You know, from the Vietnam War, and then Mao. I saw the Little Red Book. The first time I ever read it, that's Mao's Little Red Book. Yeah, it was a big deal back then. In the 60s, so people do grow up, and they can turn around. Now there's still some wacko people from around like Bernie Sanders. You know, he never got over the fact that he spent his honeymoon in Moscow in the Soviet Union. This guy's a real nut. And there are some. I knew those people. I knew a lot of these people. He's older than I am, but I knew people like him when I was. I went to Kent State where the people were shot. I went there for 2 years. I went a semester after. Took 3 years off and played in rock and roll bands, and then went back to school. I know I had long hair. It was no more. Man plans, God laughs. You know, it's anyway. There is a danger,
okay.
So that's why it's important you are here. It's important we have organizations like YAF, and I think it's important enough that I wrote a book, and I'm going around talking to as many groups of young people as I can.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is Juana, and I go to Warren Township High School.
Hi, Juana.
Warren
Township in what state?
Gurnee, Illinois.
Illinois, okay.
Yeah. But Illinois, that's another story. But
my wife is from Illinois.
Cool. But I wanted to ask, how do you feel about muckrakers, like, during the Industrial Revolution? Do you think that they improved conditions for workers, or they actually weakened the economy and expanded government power?
Well, you know, I have a whole chapter on that in the book. I think it's chapter 3. But what people call the Gilded Age is what you're asking about, where the muckrakers were kind of in power. It was the age where prosperity was spread across broader demographics than in any country or at any time in the history of the world. We built the railroads, that we built the metal skeleton that went across our country. The government gave out land so that we could have farmers who would grow food. They put it on the trains. Immigrants came into this country that were engaged in manufacturing. The trains brought the food to feed them. Industrialization it was absolutely incredible. So it was a very, very productive age. It's maligned and I think unfairly so. Now look, when you talk about people like Rockefeller or Ford, or Morgan, or Vanderbilt, I'm not here arguing that these were like morally good people. What I'm here telling you is the way that they made their money was incredibly benefiting everybody else in the country. If they hadn't, they wouldn't have gotten the money. Now, they may not have done with their money what you would have done or what you would have chosen to do. This isn't about morality. But they lifted a lot of people out of poverty, and I think that's important too. So, I don't think the muckraking characterizations that you hear are fair at all.
Thank you.
You're welcome. But that's one of my favorite chapters in the book. It was fun to write. You should, if you get a chance, take a look at it. Yes.
Hello. First, thank you for coming.
My pleasure.
But I'm Elijah, and I'm from King's Christian Collegiate in Ontario, Canada.
Oh, what Canadian?
Yeah. And
My favorite Canadian. What are the people that live in Nova Scotia? They always make fun of them. What are they?
Oh, East Coasters.
Yeah, I can't remember what they call them. Anyway. Go ahead.
Can I ask two quick questions?
Sure.
Well, my first question is, do you think that it's harder for younger people who are trying to build up their lives in the West, like Canada and America, do you think it's harder for them today because of inflation? Or do you think that it's at the same level?
I mean, harder than when?
Then, let's say the baby boomer generation.
For me, I had to work my way through college and law school. My dad was a car salesman, and he had five kids. I was the oldest, so they had no money. And then I got married, which, I'm glad I did. I had three kids early, and I'm glad I did too, because now I love them, and they've got grandkids. But it was probably pretty stupid. I mean, my oldest son is born when I was 21. Now, he's one of our nation's nuclear physicists. He lives in Livermore, California, works on our nuclear weapons programs. So, good kid. My next son is a lawyer and a CEO of a tech startup, and my daughter was a fashion designer, so I'm glad we have the kids. But look, it was very, very difficult. I had to work two jobs, went to law school. I worked every dirty job you can think of. I painted houses, I cut lawns. I busted up concrete in the summer. Anybody been to St. Louis in the summer? It's really, really miserable. But I busted up concrete in the summer and threw the big chunks with a jackhammer and threw the chunks on the back of a truck to get through law school. So it's always tough. There are benefits to being young now. There are some. There were benefits to being young then, but it's hard for me to say. I know my kids have it easier because I help them. But but I don't know. I don't think it's inflation. If anything, it's there's been a lot of inflation in the cost of education because of the way the U.S. federal government handles student loans. They just keep lending more and more money. When I got a student loan for $10,000 when I was in law school, which, by the way, was a huge deal. My first job, I made like $19,000, right, as a lawyer. So $10,000 was a big deal. And I had to go through a bank. The government guaranteed the loan, but the bank had to make the credit decision. President Obama removed the banks from the credit decision. So the government just started lending young people money, and they would go, so the schools just kept raising tuition and paying, guess who, administrators that ran the school and teachers and professors. So their salaries kept going up. The students became shovels. They would take money from the federal government and shovel it to the schools. And then people ended up with, I remember there was, what was that sit-in at Washington, in Wall Street called, right? There was this big thing on Wall Street a few years ago where people were sitting in and carrying signs about how evil Wall Street was. What's that called? Occupy Wall Street. Thanks, Carl. And there was a young lady who had a sign that said, degree in transgender studies, $130,000 in loans, can't find a job. What job do you think you were going to find? If a bank had been, nothing wrong with studying transgender studies or anything else you want to study. But don't get out thinking you're going to get a job. Are you going to open a transgender studies store? A bank would not have made that loan. So here this woman's got a ton of debt, and she didn't know what to do. Well, I feel sorry for her. So I think that you would think the loans would have made things more easier, would have made them easier. I think they probably made them more difficult.
And my quick second question is just, recently South Africa did the repatriation of land back to black natives and took it away from the white Dutch colonialists. So I was wondering, do you think that that is a smart move towards them trying to rebuild their economy and give power back to the people, or do you think that it should have been done in a different way?
Well, they did it in Rhodesia, mm-hmm. Which used to be, or Zimbabwe, which used to be called Rhodesia, and it was a complete disaster. I mean, the country's going down the toilet. So it's, sometimes these things sound really good and sound really fair, and they end up hurting not only the people that you want to hurt, they end up hurting the people you're trying to help. I'm not all that familiar with the South African economy, so it's a little difficult for me to say, but I know it didn't work in Zimbabwe.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Thank you.
Hi. I'm Michael.
Hi, Michael.
From Kettle Run High School, 30 miles south of here.
Great.
So my question is, the poverty chart, the one that had the...
One up and one down, that chart?
No.
World Bank one that just goes down, yeah.
That one? Did that include the increase of standards of living in the poverty chart?
That was just based on who was living in extreme poverty. So that chart was not based on standard of living. The chart that I showed you post-Soviet Union, it covered poverty, hunger, pollution, child mortality, that was more standard of living.
Okay.
And GDP per capita, normally, countries with higher GDP per capita have better standards of living. For example, Hong Kong, the GDP per capita is about $46,000 a year. In China, it's $10,000. People don't know this, but the GDP per capita in China is about the same as Romania. I mean, China's a very rich country, but they have a lot of very poor people and a way to go before they're very successful. In the United States, GDP per capita is $62,000 per person. So it's even better if you can align GDP per capita with adults, then you get a much better sense for a country's prosperity. But that's a pretty good measure.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Josh. I'm
Josh
from Surrey, BC, and I'm homeschooled. And I was just wondering, I was told that China was more of a communist country.
It is a communist country.
Yeah, and I'm just wondering how they can be growing economically, because communists have kind of a lot of similarities to socialism.
Well, I think what you need, communism is the idea with communism is you'll start with the dictatorship and you'll evolve to where there's a community that takes, you don't need a government anymore. That's kind of the idea. But what it's become is communism is just a way of instilling dictatorships. The dictatorships never became communal. They never went beyond anything other than a dictatorship, because once those people in power get the power of a dictator, they don't want to give it up. So the question is, you can have a dictatorship and then have capitalist or socialist economy. Now, it would be tough to have a capitalist economy with a dictatorship, because then you have to give people a lot of freedom, and that generally leads to efforts to get political freedom. China's got, I think 40% of China's economy is controlled by what they call state-owned entities, which are basically owned by people on the Politburo that control the country. They're the political elites. 60% are small businesses that the Chinese are very entrepreneurial people traditionally. So they do have some entrepreneurship in their country. And that's why GDP per capita has gone up. It's actually gone up to 10,000. During Mao Zedong's reign, it was like probably 2,000. I mean, they've made some substantial improvements. But you can have a dictatorship and different forms of an economy.
Okay. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Hello. Hi. I am Nathaniel. I go to Heritage Christian Online.
Great.
My question is that in Canada, the government is hammering down on small business, calling them tax cheats. So most small business is shutting down, meaning less employment. So what do you think about that?
Well, I think that's, when you hurt small businesses, you hurt with the economy, whatever country. You know, look, Apple started out as a small business. You probably all know this, but Steve Jobs started Apple in his garage with two buddies. You know, Henry Ford built the first Ford in a bike shop. I mean, Jeff Bezos, you know, he was bankrupt for years and years. And you could have bought Amazon stock for like 10 bucks 15, 20 years ago. I mean, so it's, if you hurt, in this country, 66% of the jobs are in small businesses. Small businesses employ 66% of people. You start hurting them, it's bad for the economy. Look, Canada's had some real problems, and I hope that this Trudeau loses this next election, because the country really needs to turn around. But I'm not an expert on Canada either. So it's fun to talk about it. I just, you know, it's like people say, are you an economist? I say, no, but I do play one on TV regularly. Thank you.
Thank you.
That's it? Okay. Last question. By the way, some people had questions. I'm out there signing books. If you want to ask questions out there, you can. Don't feel like, you know, you're not going to get to ask.
Okay. Hello, my name is Daniel Jackson. I'm from Atlanta, Georgia. I attend the
Never would have guessed.
I attend the NCHEA homeschool group. My question is about this economic boom. I've been hearing a lot of it, but I've also been hearing of large companies like Target, Starbucks, even Sam's Club, closing stores, laying off employees, and so I suppose my question is, where is this economic boom, you know, what is it affecting? Because it seems to me, like even in my family-owned business has been slow lately, you know, so I don't know where this economic boom is really taking place, if it's national or if it's just centralized somewhere. What's the deal with
that? These things are always regional, so you're going to have more growth in some areas than other areas. What business is your family in?
Airbag safety apparel, which is unusual.
Yeah. Well, I have absolutely no comments on that industry because I know absolutely nothing about it. But Target, Amazon, and they just announced they're hiring 180,000 people. When you have a lot of units like a Starbucks, you will, the same thing when you had Carl's and Hardee's, even though the brands are doing very well, you have sites that are no longer viable. For example, you might have a restaurant in downtown Atlanta, mm-hmm. but you know, the business moves out to the mall in Buckhead. You know, well, so you're going to move to Buckhead, right? You're going to close your store in Atlanta. So a lot of times retail stores will open and close. The economy is very strong. There is all of you can check this out, and I would encourage you to do so because it'll help you cut through the media BS. But the St. Louis Fed, and they call it St. Louis Fred, F-R-E-D, so the Federal Reserve Bank in St. Louis, publishes monthly something called a recession probability analysis. And it's historically, they've got a graph that's very, very good at predicting recessions. And if the probability is over 80%, then you're going to have a recession. If it's under 20%, the likelihood of a recession is very remote. That just came out a couple of weeks ago. The likelihood of recession is 1.5%, which should give you some idea just how legitimate what you've been hearing in the news is. And we just heard retail sales. I'm sorry about your company, but retail sales have been tremendous. Hmm. I mean, it's in second quarter, retail sales grew year over year 4.7%. That's the most they've grown since 2013. It's the second most they've grown since 2003. And they surged in July, and the numbers for August just came out today, and they were double what the experts were predicting. Retail sales, consumer spending, how much you guys spend, determined 68% of our GDP growth last year. Over two-thirds, 68%. Was based on consumer spending, and consumer spending is strong. So, maybe we can talk later, and you can explain your business to me. But the economy's really good.
Okay. I just perhaps I'm not following enough. You know?
Anyway,
I don't watch much TV. See.
Well, that's probably not a bad thing. Anyway, thanks everybody. This was wonderful. It's a pleasure to speak to you all.